Hi guys, Design Syndrome here. In this video, I'll teach you a really cool steamed glass refraction effect in Adobe Photoshop that you can use to give your pieces a really enigmatic and sleek finish. And by the end of the tutorial, I'll teach you a really cool variation, so you might want to stick around to the end. Always remember guys, try to think of these effect tutorials as containers. They are like a cup of coffee. And usually when you order a cup of coffee, what you're really after is the liquid that's inside. So let's try to not focus too much on the cup. The final effect that the tutorial is trying to teach you, it's the cup. So what's the liquid? Understanding of layers, of masks, how do filters work, the broadening of your skill set and understanding of design programs. What I'm going with this, it's try to not just follow the tutorial step by step, reaching from point A to point B, but instead try to understand what each command does. So with each tutorial you follow, be it one of mine or any other creators, you're not just adding another effect to the list of executable commands, you're actually broadening your core understanding of Photoshop. So in the future, you can come up with your own ways and solutions that will give your work its uniqueness. And with Photoshop being industry standard, many of the principles learned will transfer into other design programs. So by shifting your focus from following a tutorial till the end result to understanding the process that gets the result, you are making your understanding of the tool grow like a bubble instead of a straight line. This concept is something you can apply to your life at large. Gee, but I'm getting sidetracked. I'm gonna leave this for another video. Let's hop into Photoshop. First, we're gonna open up the file that we'll be working on. I try to emulate here something similar to what you might be working with. A background layer with some layers on top. So now the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna try to get the shape that we're gonna use for the glass shape. So we're gonna make a new layer, use the elliptical tool just to make a circle like so. Let's put it here, edit, fill, 50% gray. This will be our future glass shape. Now we need a way to grab all these layers and have them duplicated and clipped to that shape. We could, for example, make a duplicate of all the layers, make a group layer and use a mask of that shape in the group, something like this. And this way we are getting a duplicate, but we are not able to apply effects to that cutout. So that's not good for us. We need to grab all these layers and duplicate them into a smart object to do us the refraction when we clip it to the shape. Let's grab all the layers. Let's go to layer. Smart object, convert to smart object. And now we can duplicate it with Alt and dragging it around, put it on top of the shape, create clipping mask, and let's call this refraction. What is also practical about the smart layer is that the duplicates are also connected. So let's say we want to change something later down the line. We want to change the position of the text. Then when we close the smart layer again, it updates also in the refraction. So that's really handy to know. I'm gonna go back now just to show you. The next step is to add some blurriness to the refraction. This one's fairly easy. I feel that you might have already figured it out. We're gonna click the refraction layer. We're gonna go to filter, blur, Gaussian blur, and let's give it a fairly aggressive blur so the effect is taking place in a way that we can notice. Something like that, it's okay, I feel like. Let's press okay, and then we have it. We are starting to get close. Here, as you can see, we can grab the shape layer and move it around, and the Gaussian blur effect, it stays with the layer clipped to the refraction mask. So next, it's to add the layer styles to the shape layer itself. So to do that, let's click on the layer of the shape and go to the effects panel here. Blending options, let me move this a bit here. Here we're gonna start with a bevel and emboss layer. We're gonna set the inner bevel, the technique to chisel hard. This one doesn't matter too much. I like it in chisel hard. Depth all the way to the mask, direction up, size. Let's go for something really small because it's just to get that nice like rim line, you know? So let's do something like 2. Soften, let's give it a 3, something like that. Let me go to the default list here. Sorry, let's go again. Bevel emboss. Okay, it's copying my previous settings. That's perfect. Gloss contour, let's leave it at lineal. The angle, I like to leave it all the way to the edge. I want to copy like the illumination maybe of the image on the background. And what's important to understand about this angle setting and the altitude setting that it has also below it, it's that, let's say that this is our layer, the angle is gonna determine where the light source is located, and the altitude is gonna determine in sort of a dome shape where in the sky it's sort of the light source, you know? And sometimes when you place it in zero altitude, like this coming from here, sometimes you don't get the shadow on the other side of your layers. You need to give it a bit more altitude, something like maybe 15 here, and you see we get that nice shadow here. Glass contour, we're gonna leave it linear. I explained this a bit how it works on the Chrome tutorial, you will have it here somewhere. And for the highlights here, you might have it in normal. I like to do the highlights on linear dodge and the shadows on linear burn. And you see how you get like pure white and pure black for the highlights and the shadows here. It's important to handle with subtlety, you know, because it looks more natural that way. If you do the linear burn, for example, 16, 17, I think it's okay. The highlights a bit more noticeable, like that I think works fine. Now let's add a stroke. It's gonna be really small, pretty imperceptible. You play around within around 1 and 2 pixels for the size, set it on the inside. The blend mode, again, let's set it at linear dodge. The opacity 100% for now, we need to see it first. The color, we're gonna set a gradient. The gradient, we're gonna make it linear. And in here, what it's doing, a linear gradient, it's sort of wrapping around that linear gradient, is wrapping it around the form of our layer, right? So what we're gonna do now is gonna introduce a bit of chaos into that gradient, to simulate a bit of that bounce light that we get from the environment back into the glass shape. So we get that really thin bounce light at the edge of it. So we're gonna add maybe a grayish color here, and we're gonna put the black, and maybe we can put another black again here, something like that. Let's make this black a bit darker gray. This one also, something like this, I think works. For the angle, I like to play around with it. Let's make this one. I like to play around with it so we get a bit of the white part in here where we have the shadow from the bevel and emboss, right? Overprint, let's leave it at okay. So it prints over the shadow and it's not taking that information away. Now, what I want to add, it's sort of a light bleed from coming from the side of the glass shape and tinting, giving a bit of highlight into the glass shape. To do that, we could do that with inner glow and something like this. You see how the sort of light that hits the sides of the glass shape on its contour, like bleed inside. But the problem with this one is that it's even from all sides, and I wanted to follow the directionality that we gave it with the bevel and emboss. So I wanted it to hit from the top left side a bit more. So to do that, we're gonna do it with inner shadow. We're gonna set it to linear dodge. We're gonna put it in white. And what's cool about this one is that we can tweak the size and the distance and also the angle. You see, I can put it from below and also from the top side with a bit more distance, a bit more size. And let's make it a lot more subtle, something like that. You see, and like that, it starts to follow the direction of the light from coming from above and also tainting the glass, you know? This looks perfect. Again, no choke, play with the size and distance. Contour, let's leave it at linear, no noise. Or maybe you can play with a bit of noise, but let's leave it with no noise. We're gonna add a bit of noise later. Next, what we're gonna do is we're gonna add a drop shadow to this. We're gonna click on the drop shadow. I like to make my shadows linear burn. We're gonna set it as black. We're gonna increase a bit the size and the distance. No spread, something like this. Let's reduce a bit more the opacity to make it really subtle, because this is glass. Remember, it's not like a solid shape, so it's not gonna cast like a harsh shadow. You know, it's gonna be really subtle. For the angle, make it match also the direction of the light, of course. And for the contour, in this one, we are gonna change it to bell curve. And what this curve does, it's that, for example, this represents the inner part. This part, if I leave it to linear, let me put the bell curve, but let me show you in a more obvious way. Let's crank the opacity all the way up and the distance. And you can see how the shadow is projecting sort of like a ring, right? This is because if I put it so linear, you can see all the shadow, right? This represents this end, the rightmost end of the curve map represents the inner part of the shape, and this one's the outer part of the shape, right? If I bring this all the way to the bottom, all to the bottom, you get no shadow. And if I bump the middle part, we get shadow in what would be the in-between between the middle of the shape and the edge of the shadow, right? So actually, a more accurate way to do this would be to lift this a bit up, because we should get less of a shadow where we have the glass. But the purpose of this is that from the perspective of where the light is hitting, we have a bit of more material like in the edges that the light needs to go through. So we would get that kind of sort of ring light, right? So this would be like the more accurate one. Let's leave the bell curve here. And let's put this one maybe like so, so we don't get that perfect ring, but a bit less opacity towards the middle. Let's leave this okay, turn down the opacity again, reduce the distance till where we had it. Like that, I think looks perfect. And now we're gonna duplicate this shadow. And as it duplicates, we're gonna leave the one that's sitting below as the dark shadow. And on top of it, this drop shadow, we're gonna set to linear dodge and we're gonna do white. And this is gonna create some sort of highlight. If we move it around, you see it. I wanna increase the opacity, so you see it. And this one is gonna sit just inside of the shadow. We're gonna give it even less opacity than the shadow, a bit less size, so it's a bit sharper. And what this one would represent, it's a bit of bloom of the light hitting the glass shape. And also, let's say the glass shape has a bit of a depth to it. So light is coming in from the sides, bouncing all inside the glass shape and coming out the other end, projecting that sort of into the surface that's below. I don't know if the physics are correct on that one, but it looks correct when we do it this way. So that's the entire point. It looks correct. Once you have this, you can go to styles, new style, save it, design syndrome glass. And there you have it for later. It just stays there. And there you have it. Now what we're gonna do is we're gonna add a noise on top of the refraction. We're gonna do the noise that I teach you how to do on the texturing tutorial. You can see it here or whatever, you know. It's super easy to do. We're just gonna make a new layer, edit fill, 50% gray. From here, we're gonna go to blur gallery, fill blur. I don't know if you can see it here. In the noise tab, we're gonna go around here. It's okay, 72%. We're gonna click okay. And when you have it like this, just clip it to the refraction layer below, set it to overlay and opacity, play around with it so it's not overly aggressive, you know. I think like that it looks fire. I like to give it also a really subtle blur, Gaussian blur, like 1 or 0.5. I think it's cool. We have it like that. It's solid as it is. Now what we're gonna do is try to do the steamed effect. Okay guys, up to here, I've created a free action that you can download from the links below that will get you to this exact point, a one-click Glassmorph layer. And if you'd like to support the channel further while getting some tools to help you save time and experiment further, I've made an extended version with over 20 more really cool layer styles with textures, overlays, and additional displacement maps that will come really handy for the last part of the tutorial where I'll teach you the next effect. If you want to check those out, just click the link below. Moving on with the tutorial. For the steamed look, what we need is a way to get the blur on the refraction to be a bit sectorized, but in a chaotic, like random way. And for that, we're gonna make use of the mask channel in the smart filters layer. And if you don't know how mask work, it's pretty simple. You can see here that the smart layer, now the mask, it's all white, which is telling Photoshop to apply the Gaussian blur evenly throughout all the layer, right? The surface of all the layer. You can see if I stand in the mask thumbnail here and I press Alt, it's gonna take me into the mask channel. So now I can see the content of the mask. And I, for example, if I grab my brush and I paint with black here, let's make it harsher, with black, and I go back to the RGB channel by pressing the other thumbnail of the refraction layer, you can see that there the blur is not applying because here in the mask, we have it as black, right? If I paint again with white, it shows again, really simple, right? If I select the layer, you don't need to go inside of the channel every time, you can just select the thumbnail. If I paint even with a less harsh, you can see how the effect has a gradation till it shows the effect applying, right? Because here we have it like that with a gradation. It reads the gradients and tells Photoshop how much to let the effect of the layer that is trying to show or masking come through, right? So let's go back to the RGB layer. What we're gonna do is you're gonna paint everything white again. What we're gonna do now is we need to create some sort of irregular noise that we can then map into this mask layer to tell Photoshop to in what sectors to apply the filter to make it look frosted. What we're gonna do is gonna create a new layer. We're gonna go to filter, render cloud. This we have like a randomly generated cloud. For you, they might look different. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna press Control A, or you need to go to select all. We're gonna copy. We're gonna disable this layer for now. We might need it later. And we're gonna enter again the mask channel, right, in the smart filter. So we're gonna press Alt and click here. And once we are here, we're gonna press Control Shift B, or I think it's Edit, paste special, paste in place. And what that will do, it's gonna paste it in the same position that you copied from, right? Relative to the canvas. So you get it in the same position. But right now, if we go back to the refraction, you can see how it's sort of a little bit muddied, right? But it's not overly showing, not overly not. So let me show you one thing. Let's go again to the mask, pressing Alt, and let's see what happens if I go to image adjustments levels, right? If I start to play with the levels and bring it closer, and I don't want it super sharp, something like this, and I don't want it even something so diffused that it's, but just to show you, let's do it really aggressive like this and go back to the refraction channel. And there you can see how we used the clouds to create that sort of sectorization we needed for the effect to take place. Now let's go back with Control C to the original clouds. And now we don't need to go back again inside the channel. We can just select the thumbnail. From this, what I like to do is apply a filter to the clouds first, the blur, a Gaussian blur, a really subtle Gaussian blur, because I don't want that much noise and texture to come through when we do the levels again. Once we did that in the smart layer, then we go again, image, adjustments, levels, and now from the RGB channel, you can see how we can make it a really cool steamed effect. I want it more aggressive on this side. Just remember to not close it all the way like a threshold, leave it a bit open, something like this, it's sort of the sweet spot. And there you have it, a really cool steamed glass effect. Remember that you can go back to the shape layer and move it around, you can shrink it, you can do whatever you want. For the bonus track, another thing that I want to show you, it's, let's just grab this, put it in a group, duplicate it. We're gonna disable this one just to save it. Let's get rid of the clouds layer. And in this one, the new one that we created, let's erase the, let's turn all to white the mask for the smart filter. Edit fill, white, it's all white again. Now what we can do, let's turn the Gaussian blur a bit down for this one. And one refraction, we're gonna do one distortion that is really cool. We're gonna go to filter, filter gallery, in the distortion glass, if we go to tiny lens in texture, you have logs, you have canvas, but the tiny lens, I think it looks really cool. Let's play with the distortion a bit more, maybe less distorted, less smoothness, a bit more scaling, press okay, and you get that this really nice distortion in your glass effect. But you can take it a bit step further. You can create your own refraction by creating your own displacement maps, which is really easy to do. Let's create a new document, not so big, 700 by 700, it's okay, I think. Really simple. Let's create like a linear gradient with the gradient tool from black to white. Super simple. Let's make it from white to pure black, something like this, completely horizontal and linear. Let's rasterize this layer. Let's get rid of this mask that we have here. Now we have the layer. And now let's just create this sort of pattern. When we have something like this, what we're gonna do now, we're gonna merge all the layers, delete the background, and like so, we're gonna save it on computer. Let's save it here as displacement, and let's go back to our other file. And in this one, let's go back to the filter gallery effect here. If we go next to the texture, you can see here, we press this icon, you can load the texture. And here, let's load up this displacement that we've created. And you can see here how the texture starts to take place. As it is, it looks really cool, but let's leave it a bit more scaling, less smoothness, and let's bring the distortion all the way to the top. Let's add a bit of smoothness, like that looks epic. So there you have it, my guys. The possibilities are endless. Go in, go crazy, make it really your own. So that was it, my guys. I hope you liked it and hopefully learned something new. Remember to subscribe to the channel, click the bell icon so you don't miss any of the future videos and previews coming your way. Also, guys, don't forget to stop by the store where you'll find a bunch of assets and resources that I've created so you can spend the time where it really matters, not in Google searching for graphic textures, mockups, all of that, but working and ingraining your process, having fun, or maybe not having fun. The creative process is really painful. It's really hard to pull through sometimes, but over here, it's what we're all about. This is what we do, you know what I mean? So see you on the next one, Shay. Fuck peace, wish you conflict.